Goed, goeiedag 1GT411 studenten. Dit is week 4, ons behandel vandag die bykie wat oor is van studie eenheid 2 en met elemente van studie eenheid 1, as ook ons begin kortliks met studie eenheid 3. Met weer een herinnering aan die kontakbesonderhede, onthou asseblief as iets dringend is, e-pos my direk en ek kan vir jou vinnige antwoord gee, anders kan jy dit deur mevrou Bischoff werk. So gepraat van mevrou Bischoff, die E-klas toets 1 is gelaai en sal oopmaak vrijdag om 8:00 die ochend en hy sluit dinsdag die 23ste om 11:00 die aand. Hy tel 'n bietjie minder punte as wat daar aangedui is, maar sy gewig is nog steeds dieselfde. Okay, what are we going to do today? We are going to finish covering basic terms that you as a student should know in order to successfully analyze any literary text. And then we're going to have an introductory discussion on critical analysis. Also be aware, let ook op, daarop dat ek deur die loop van die aanbieding vir jou sekere opdragte gaan gee om na E-klas toe te gaan onder die forum waarin jy sekere vrae moet antwoord en waar jy mekaar ook kan help om daardie vrae te antwoord. Excuse. Okay. Just a recap of what we did last week. We discussed the theme of Lord of the Flies. There's just the basic definition of what a theme is. Hier is alles net herziening van wat ons gedeeltelik last week gedoen het, of last keer gedoen het. Then we said there are a couple of, there's just an extension of what a theme is. There are a couple of themes in Lord of the Flies. One, for example, is civilization versus savagery or vice against virtue, where it basically implies you can directly compare the two groups in the book, as well as the circumstance behind this, behind the story, the war itself. And then there's the comparison lies in the antagonistic and the protagonistic side. So die oorlog wat in die boek afspeel, is die agtergrond, nie die Tweede Wereldoorlog self nie, onthou hierdie is 'n fiksiewerk. Die Tweede Wereldoorlog was Golding, die skrywer se eie agtergrond, maar in die boek is dit 'n nuwe oorlog, en die vergelyking lê daarin om die twee groepe te vergelyk. Okay. Then we also said what civilization means under this topic, that they all came from a civilized society, and we discussed some symbols that represents civilization in the book, and then of course opposing symbols which represent the lack of civilization that we discuss on this slide. And of course, the lack of civilization, it can generally be called savagery. And then there's this whole struggle for and against civilization. The next theme that we discussed was man's inherent evil, or the savageness and society. Baie verbind aan die eerste thema ook, dis maar net 'n bietjie ander anders gefraseer. Jy kan ook elemente wat jy in haar eerste thema behandel, kan jy ook hierso behandel. It goes back to order, and order that's related to democracy and civilization, where there are some rules. Een voorbeeld ons sê is die conch, maar daar is ook die gevaar dat daar te veel orde is, too much order in society. Then we, the examples we said regarding the characters of Jack and Ralph, and then elements of disorder that we find as well, corruption that we find mostly in Jack's group. And then if we carry on, Jack's innocence that was corrupted as the book carries on. And we can also make the statement that people are both good and evil, and that there's a struggle between this these two. Dit gaan natuurlijk ook weer terug na jou christelike perspektief wat ons laas week bespreek het. Jy is natuurlijk welkom ook om daarna te verwys, dit is nie noodwendig jou hoofpunt daarachter nie, maar omdat ons ARO studente is, is dit die bril waardeur ons ook daarna kyk. As jy verder daarover gesels, is jy welkom om my ook te kom. Okay, let's carry on. The next, okay, there's another example there of Simon being good while Roger is evil. Gaan kyk maar weer daarna en gaan luister weer daarna soos wat ons dit in vorige week bespreek het. The next thing we said we could possibly find is war in the future of mankind. This is more a theme that has very a lot of possibilities. That's not as focused as the previous two themes. We said Golding has a lot of symbols. There are also some motifs. Ons gaan ook weer vinnig kyk na wat motiewe is, and then I'm going to tell you exactly how motives differ from symbols. You can see there the points we made about order and disorder and the island as symbol in itself. And then the last possible thing, although there might still be others, is the end of rationalism. Hierdie goeters is alles met mekaar verbind, so jy kan wat jy in party temas uitlig, kan jy hier ook uitlig. The point being, when rationalism is lost, war begins. The island as a beacon, the boys as soldiers of rationalism, that some move to the end of rationalism. And then what Golding is trying to show, that human nature is inherently evil. These things will become a little bit more clear to you when we start discussing critical analysis. Jy moet net seker gemaak, jy verstaan waarna ons verwys as ons daarby kom. Okay, and then of course the conclusion around this man is his own greatest friend and enemy, because he created rationalism, but he can also destroy it. Okay, motives, we're going to have a look at again briefly just as a recap. Last week we said motives are very similar to theme, although that they are dominant or recurring ideas. Themes is the general idea behind the story, while the motive is something that recurs again and again in the story and supports a particular theme. It can be an image, a sound, or an action, as we just said, and there can be symbolism behind this. The important thing, okay, there's just more examples. I mentioned the James Bond theme as well. The whole theme behind his vodka martini, shaken not stirred, is something that returns in all the James Bond films. There's just example of some motifs. The conch is one, the forest is one, the beast is one as well, and the sky in the forest is another thing. The important thing to remember about a motif, it is something that changes as the story or the narrative progresses. So it doesn't stay the same. It recurs continually, but it changes there's change every time it occurs. Piggy's glasses is another thing as well. At the beginning of the stories, Piggy's glasses is intact, they are not broken. Then one lens breaks, and eventually at the end of the story, both lenses are broken. Okay, die belangrike ding, the important thing that we must remember, the difference between a symbol and a motif. A motif is a symbol, or a recurring symbol, that changes as the narrative progresses, while a symbol is something that stays the same but is repeated. So there's the essential difference. The motive changes as the story progresses, while a symbol stays the same. Okay, goed, kom ons gaan verder. Ek wil net vir julle nog een ding sê rondom die verskil tussen twee. The conch, for example, cannot be a symbol because it changes. Dit verander in wat dit beteken, en dit breek eventueel, daai groot see skulp wat hulle gebruik om mekaar te roep. So it's not a symbol, it's a motive in this case. Symbols are other instances which we'll discuss as we carry on. Jy kan byvoorbeeld sê, a symbool in die story is byvoorbeeld die soeke na orde in die Ralph's dad is in the Navy, and at the end this symbol returns when they find the sea soldier or the marine that finds them on the island. So that is a constant symbol. It's for another glad. Okay, where a motif changes throughout the story. Okay, I'd like to discuss then today further terms for critical analysis, things that you need to know in order to refer to when you do a critical analysis. These are things that aren't necessarily as apparent in Lord of the Flies, but I will also refer back to Lord of the Flies as we discuss them before we start discussing what is expected of you when you do your critical analysis in your essay, be it in your semester assignment or eventually in your exam. Okay, the first thing I want to discuss here is the term genre, it comes from the French, which means type or kind. Literature has four main genres, namely poetry, drama, fiction, and non-fiction. In this module, we are concentrating exclusively on fiction. And then obviously the two subdivisions here is the novel and film. The novel can be defined as follows: always a book length, it's always fictional. It has characters in the plot which you've already encountered. It's more developed than a short story, and there might be various perspective or points of view that we'll discuss later. And then there's also a narrator in the novel who tells the story, something which we'll also discuss later, but it's not the author. Gaan kyk ook op e-klas, het ek vir julle tipe van 'n boek gegee waar daar extra terme is wat jy moet ken vir jou e-klas toets. Gaan klik net daar op, ek het dit wel gemerk. Okay, if we continue and we get to a narrative is just a more formal term that we use to say what happens in the story. It's basically how events unfold in the story, and how settings change, what themes there are, and what motives supports these themes. The narrative is basically the device used to broadcast the theme and the motives associated with it. Dit is die story self, die verloop van die story, die narratief, as jy nou direct vertaal, dit word in Afrikaans ook as die narratief beskou van die story, die hele ontvouwing van die story daarachter. Okay, if we then get to point of view, as my muis net wil saamwerk, excuse, hy wil nou nie lekker scroll nie. If we get to point of view, there are three kinds, which we discuss now, but it basically tells you from whose point of view the story is told. The story, of course, is told by a narrator. The narrative is told by a narrator. It can be a character. It can involve dialogues, actions, settings, and events. So the narrator itself can be in the story, where it's usually a first-person narrator, where we find I, or the pronouns I or we. Can also be a second person narrator, but this is very scarce, where we find the pronoun you for a second person narrator. And it can then also be a third person narrator, which is also quite common, where we find the pronouns he, she, it, and they. We're going to discuss each of these narrators shortly, but these are the types that you find, and they represent the point of view from which the narrative is told. Okay, let's first get to the first person narrator. As I said, it uses the pronoun I, sometimes we, and this narrator speaks from his or her subject position. They are usually a character, and they tell the story from their perspective. Okay, they can interact with the other characters, and we see these interactions through that narrator's eyes. But we cannot see anything else that narrator does not see. There's a visual representation. Only what that narrator can see is the characteristics of a first person narrator. The next one we find is a second person. It's very scarce. Basically, if I attempted at giving you an example, the narrative would go like something. You walk to the table, you put the book on the table, you sit down at the chair. That you pronoun is predominant. It's very scarce because it's very difficult to write in that way throughout an entire a novel. Then lastly, the third person narrator, if my scroller would just work, third person narrator is not a character in the story, but it is an observer. So I always think of if you've got a helicopter that can rise above the story and see everything that is happening above the story, or a drone in the modern sense, that is what the third person narrator is. It can be an omniscient third person narrator, which is able to tell what all characters are thinking, but that is not always the case. You always find the limited third person narrator, which can see most things but not all things, what the individual character perceives and what they think. there's a visual representation you'll see there in terms of omniscient. There's something similar to my helicopter symbol that I used. In this case, there's only some observation made by the third person narrator, but importantly, they are not characters in the story. So you get your first person narrator with the pronouns I and sometimes we, a character in the story. Your second person narrator, which is very scarce, but also a character in the story, and the pronoun you is used. And then your third person narrator, which is not a character in the story, and these can be either omniscient third person or limited. Omniscient, knowing, being able to see what all characters think and do, and a third person limited narrator, being able to only see what some of the things that the characters do, but both, in both cases, they are not characters in the story. Dis amper soos 'n spook in die storie wat mens nie kan sien. Okay, if we move on then, I'd like to discuss the term conflict. Conflict word vir julle redelik ooglopend te wees. It should be very apparent. That's the problems or complications in the story. In other words, that which changes the normality at the start of the story. Dit wat normaal was aan die begin van die story, word verander binne in die story, en dan moet die hele story deurloop om weer aan daai normaliteit te kom. If you look at Shakespeare's Macbeth, for example, the character of Macbeth illegally ascended the Scottish throne. So, in die begin van Macbeth was die Skotse troon of Skotse koningskap deur natuurlike maniere verander, en toe kom Macbeth en hy maak die koning dood en hy klim op die troon, en dit is onnatuurlik en dit is daar waar die konflik of the conflict happened. Okay, the next term that I'd like to discuss, rising and falling action, and then the climax that we find here in the middle. The rising action happens before the climax. It's part of the story or narrative which precedes the climax, and it builds up, as you can see, to the climax. And the falling action is after the climax, and it is in the second half of the story. The highest point of the story is the climax. So, soos wat ons nou gepraat het oor die normale, hier is die normale hieronder, dan gebeur iets, dan bou iets op, kom jy by die klimaks, en dan jy herstel tot terug na die normale, in hierdie richting, so jy sien, geloop af, so that is the falling action. Now, in terms of point of view, and in terms of rising and falling action and climax, I'd like you to go to E-class. You see there are two forum questions set up where you have to give your opinion on where these things occur and what type of narrators you find in Lord of the Flies. Give your answer there, discuss it amongst each other. I will give you, I will take part in the discussion as well. Maybe comment on some of the answers given to you by you as a student. But please go to E-class, go to week 4, there's the forum there. Have this discussion on the forum. Ons almal leer saam en ons almal verstaan ook die story beter. Ons kan idees ook uitruil rondom die story as ons dit doen. The next thing I'd like to show you, the term is foreshadow. Now, if you look at this little figure here, dit is basis, as skaduwee kan op agterwee of voorwee wees, dit is nou maar nie simbool. Foreshadowing is a clue in the story that tells you what will happen later on in the story. Here's an example, and this is quite ironic, says you die at the end. That is what foreshadowing, an example of foreshadowing. In Lord of the Flies, kan ons julle paar voorbeelde van foreshadowing sien. The first example is Rolf's behavior towards Piggy at the beginning is a foreshadowing of what will eventually happen to Piggy, because Piggy is already showing that he's an outcast, and of course, as you know, Jack and the Hunters kill Piggy at the end. The conflict or the leadership battle between Rolf and Jack at the beginning is a foreshadowing of the ultimate battle that will happen at the end. The scar that, or the piece that of the forest that's burnt down on the island is a foreshadowing of the entire island that will burn down at the end, a foreshadowing of the chaos that will happen by the end of the story. Okay, Jesus is eigenlijk al voor uitskouwing in Afrikaans. The next term that I'd like to discuss is setting. Setting basically explains itself, the time and place, so that would be roughly after the Second World War, which the action or the story takes place, and the place is the island in the Pacific. There's all can also be a link to historical context, which of course is directly something we find in Lord of the Flies, with the historical context after the Second World War. Goed julle, ek wil nou graag aanbeweeg na kritiese analise, en dit is basis die kern van hierdie module, om jou te leer om kritisch te analyseer, om kritisch naar die tekst te kyk wat jy voor jou sien. Today I'm only going to give an introduction, basically focus more on what it is about, what is expected of you, and next week we'll actually do a critical analysis in a mock essay, and to show you how to build your own and write your own critical analysis. Okay, let's first look at the word critical. In Afrikaans is die woord kritisch baie negatief, want het betekent jy moet amper half ding sleg sê. In English, the term is not quite the same. Critical means to build an argument. It can be for or against something, but that is basically what critical means. You critique it, if you use the verb form of the word, en dit is precies wat jy hier so gaan doen. Jy gaan een bepaalde standpunt inneem in jou opstel, jy gaan dit verduidelik, en jy gaan voorbeelde daarvan gee. Analysis is exactly that what I've just said in Afrikaans. Analysis is looking at the text, finding elements in the text to support or go against a particular argument. Analyseer is jy analyseer, as jy na jou assessering in tweede jaar onthou, daar by die bloemsvlakke, waar hulle praat van analyseer, is van die woordvlakke, jy vat die bestaande ding, jy trek het uit mekaar uit, en jy sê, hier is die komponente en dit, as jy dit kritisch daarna kyk, dan sê jy, dit is wat hierdie bepaalde goeders wat ek nou gevind het, toe ek het nou uit mekaar uitgetrek het, dit is wat dit beteken. So that, in short, if we look at epistemological level at this, is what critical analysis means. Let's look at a more practical level. Okay, I've explained the analysis part. We said it explains a work of fiction, poetry or drama by means of interpretations. Daar is een mate van interpretatie daarachter, maar een goeie interpretatie kan ondersteun word deur feite uit die tekst. We basically just going to look in fiction, both in the novel that we're doing now, Lord of the Flies, as well as the film Dead Poets Society, which you hopefully have watched already. What is the goal behind this literary analysis? It deepens and broadens our understanding of a work of literature. Boeken en boeken word daaroor geskryf, oor wat een bepaalde stuk beteken. And based on that, for example, prizes like the Nobel Prize for Literature and the Booker Prize and the Pulitzer Prize in America are awarded based on critical analysis done by outside critics, and they look at the theme that the author presents, they look at how this is done, and yes, then someone can win a prize or not for the work that they've done. Another way of interpreting it is by saying it's an analytical discussion of literary text. If we look at Sierra College's definition there, an interpretation, translate via Bepentien on, on an individual basis that addresses the meaning of a perceived text. So jy gaan gebruik jou themas, jy gaan gebruik jou motive, you use your other literary terms with which to describe your interpretation of this. Okay. There we go. The important thing that we remember here, that is why belonging, an interpretation can only be arrived at after an in-depth examination of the text and after considering the context of the text. Of jy nou een theoloog of een onderwijzer of maak nie saak wat jy is nie, elke tekst het 'n context. Ons kry dit vooral nogal in die laaste tye met goeders soos die cancel culture. Een tekst, maak nie saak wat type tekst, of het geskrewe, gesproke, soos wat julle in 2001 geleer het, visueel, een tekst word gekritiseer sonder enige context daarachter. So hulle sê eenvoudige tekst is sleg, en dit is nou sleg, en hulle is soos een klomp onbeheerbare, ongehoorsame kinders, die tekst wordt slecht afgemaakt en zwart gesmeerd, maar daar wordt geen context achter die tekst gezet. So, the important thing about an interpretation is, you can only do an interpretation after you've done an in-depth examination of the text. Okay? You also do not retell the story, that's not an interpretation, unless you are using examples from the text to prove a point as part of your interpretation. As ek jou nou 'n tip kan gee, gaan kry vir jou 'n PDF-weergawe van Lord of the Flies, waar jy kan soektogte doen, dit gaan jou net makkeliker, dit gaan jou net help om bepaalde plekke in die boek te kry, om bepaalde punte te ondersteun uit die teks uit. Okay, the next thing I'd like to discuss under critical interpretation is something more on your interpretation. It's only as strong as the proof that you provide to support your interpretation. En hoe om daai bewyse te lewer is deur, ekskuus tog, literêre terme te gebruik. So, you can for example discuss a certain thing and you use foreshadowing as proof of that. And you give a couple of examples from the text that that shows foreshadowing. The important thing is that you must provide an argument. Jy moet 'n argument en onthou argumente in Afrikaans het ook 'n redelike negatiewe konnotasie. Argumente in hierdie op hierdie opsig beteken jy bring 'n punt oor. Dit is nie gaan nie oor negatief wees. You must provide an argument that you have examples on and that you can give quotations from the text as well as your knowledge. So jy maak jou punt, die punt wat jy probeer maak, die interpretasie wat jy gee en jy sê hierdie punt word ondersteun deur hierdie uittreksels uit die teks uit, want ons sien bepaalde literêre verskynsels, terme wat hier voorkom. And by doing that, you convince your reader of your interpretation. Then the next thing that you must know, it must be carefully structured. Dit is soos enige skryfstuk, jy terugdink aan jou akag, hoekom ons dit vir jou geleer het, want in elke akademiese ding, of taak, of eksamen wat jy moet inlewer, moet daar 'n mooi struktuur wees. Want jy het net jou skryfwerk, wat vir jou kan praat op daai papier. You structure it carefully. Ek wil amper vir julle sê, as jy mooi behoorlik gestruktureer reed met kort leesbare sinne geskryf het, en jou argument is nog nie noodwendig so sterk nie, kan jy baie simpatie van 'n merker kry, omdat die stuk wat jy geskryf het maklik is om te lees. Want, as you can see there in brackets, the terms of the order in which you address certain aspects of your argument is well placed, it's readable, and even if your argument is not that strong or you haven't proved it that well, you should have some sympathy from a marker because it's easy to read what you are saying. The other important thing of thyself depend, you must write cohesively. Cohesive beteken dit moet aan mekaar vasplak, daar moet 'n verband wees tussen die twee goedes. Cohesive logical paragraphs. Ons gaan volgende week 'n bietjie na kyk hoe jy van een paragraaf in die volgende paragraaf toe kyk. Jy kan 'n bietjie weer na jou ou akag werk gaan kyk hoe jy hulle paragrawe aan mekaar verbind. And then importantly, iets wat ek nog nie van die begin af gesê het, jy mag buitebronne ook gebruik in jou verduideliking en jou interpretasie. In 'n eksamen konteks is dit nie wenig altyd moontlik nie. Maar jy hoef nie net die primêre teks te gebruik rondom dit. Jy mag gaan kyk wat ander mense gesê het oor 'n soort gelyke kritiese analise. Okay. I've said that your interpretation is only as strong. You may use secondary sources. Ek dink amper ons is klaar. Ons is ja, volgende week of volgende keer gaan ons spesifiek kyk na hoe jy, ons gaan 'n fisiese kritiese analise doen, ek gaan jou stap vir stap daardeur vat, of daardeur neem, onthou om jou e-klas toets te gaan doen, onthou om na jou addisionele inligting vir jou e-klas toets op e-klas te gaan kyk, and then also to take part in the forum where we learn together and improve our understanding of the text which we are about to critically analyse. By next week, I'm also going to put the semester assignment on e-klas, or let's say by next week, but before we meet again, then you can start having a look at it as well. Onthou asseblief as jy enige vrae het, e-pos my, vraag gerus, ek wil jou graag help, ek wil hierdie module vir jou so genotvol as moontlik maak, en dat jy dit wat jy hier leer ook verder in jou lewe kan gebruik. Mooi naweek vir julle, tot ziens.